Hey YouTube, it's going to be another Mega Mire video. This one's going to be really long, so sit back and relax and enjoy. This is going to be a very, very long video. This is like over an hour long. And it's different stories spread out.
What happened here is horrifying. Why it might have happened will leave you incredulous.
She was just a good girl.
Tina Meyer of suburban St. Louis is the mother of Megan Meyer, who had lived a challenging childhood.
She got bullied in school, and she had big self-esteem issues. She had struggled with depression since she was in the third grade.
I think I started getting depression when I was in middle school the most, and then in high school more. It was mostly in high school and middle school.
Megan's mother and father allowed her to set up a MySpace account under their supervision and said their 13-year-old swooned when she got her first affectionate note ever from a boy named Josh Evans.
He thought she was really pretty, posted on her comments on her pictures, you know, this is beautiful, your eyes are beautiful.
For about a month, Josh sent her instant messages saying things like, lucky me and lucky you, because you are my number one.
You know what? Actually, that's not even true because Josh Evans wasn't even real. And if I said lucky me and lucky you because you're my number one to the love of my life, at least I'm honest about it. Because she will always be my number one. I love her with all my heart.
But Megan's mother and father started getting suspicious because although the notes were not explicit, their parental instinct told them something wasn't right.
I did contact the police department, and I called and went, asked to be transferred to the cyber crimes division to see how can I check to see if this MySpace account is real. Nothing you can do.
And then one day...
It was a whirlwind. It was Josh saying horrible things to Megan, Megan saying things back to him.
Nasty messages from a boy who just a day before meant everything to this lonely girl. One in particular cut deep.
The world would be a better off place without you and have a shitty rest of your life.
I think he said, everybody in O'Fallon knows who you are. You're a bad person, everyone hates you. Have a shitty rest of your life. The world would be a better place without you.
Megan was distraught beyond words.
This is the part I'll never forgive myself for because she was looking for me to help, calm her down like I normally always did and be there for her, and I was upset with her because I didn't like the language that she was using, and I was upset that she didn't listen to me and sign off when I told her to, and so I was aggravated with her about that and told her that she knew better, and she just said to me, you're supposed to be my mom, you're supposed to be on my side. And she took off running upstairs.
It was too quiet for too long in that upstairs bedroom.
Tina left, walked upstairs. I didn't really pay much attention to it. And then I just heard a blood-curdling scream.
I just saw her hanging from her closet.
When she just screamed, I was right there.
I tried picking her up.
I held her. And I yanked the whole closet thing out of the wall, and Tina ran and got a knife so I could cut the belt from around her neck and then started performing CPR.
She had tears the entire time, running down the side of her face the entire, until she passed away.
Just like, please, please, Megan, breathe.
I actually want to say something to that. Blaine Buckles came over and started forming CPR on her, and he think that he did break Megan's ribs, but Blaine was a CPR guy, so he didn't know, so he knew what to do, and he said she had a slight pulse, but she wasn't breathing, and I think they got her back to breathing, but then she died later.
Megan was pronounced dead the next day. When Ron Meyer came home from the hospital, he wanted to find Josh Evans, let him know what he had done to his little girl. The first place he tried to look was Josh's MySpace page.
It was deleted. the whole Josh Evans no longer existed.
A month passed as the Myers struggled with their grief, searching for answers why their daughter went to such extremes, and who was the boy who drove her there. Then a neighbor told them something stunning. Josh Evans was actually the creation of a mother who lived on the same block as the Myers. A mother who actually went to Megan's funeral, according to an official police report, that mother acknowledged it. The report saying, in the months leading up to Myers' daughter's suicide, she instigated and monitored a MySpace account, which was created for the sole purpose of communicating with Myers' daughter. The Myers were told the other family wanted to find out from Megan why she was having a dispute with their own 13-year-old daughter.
As if my daughter would have killed herself with a gun. They loaded the gun for her.
We are not reporting the name of that other family to protect the identity of their daughter.
I know the name if you all want to know it. It's Lori Drew, and the daughter's name is Sarah Drew, and there's Ashley Grills. That's no big secret anymore because everyone knows it now because it's been 9 years now.
But did go to their home to try and get their side of the story. The woman's father answered the door. In a soft voice, the grandfather said it was sad, but then would not say if he thought the police report was wrong.
Have you talked to these people since then?
Yes, I have.
And what have you said to them?
Probably things that I can't say on camera.
I'll say a few things maybe that she's probably said, and if you're easily offended by profanity, don't watch this. She's probably said, bitch, shit, fuck, whore maybe? I don't know. Bitch. That's usually what people call people, girls, as bitches or something, you know. But, oh well.
And what about?
That's just an estimate to me.
Said back to you.
Give it a rest.
Give it a rest.
That's fucked up to say. What do you mean, give it a rest? You made their daughter kill herself! Are you that fucking mental? How would you feel if your daughter killed herself? Huh? Riddle me that! Huh? How can you say this shit? That's just crappy to say.
Now at this point, if you're waiting to hear what law enforcement is doing in an effort to get Megan and her family some justice, well, you may be waiting forever. County prosecutors, the county sheriff's office, and the FBI say there is no indication whatsoever a crime has been committed. So there are no plans to do anything legally.
That's fucking bullshit. That should be a crime.
After initially telling us they weren't even investigating the case anymore, the prosecutor is now telling CNN his office will review the situation. But more than a year has gone by since Megan hanged herself.
So that video was made in 2007, this video. But then they bunched up all the news videos together.
Tina and Ron Meyer, who have separated, partly because of the stress.
I think they got a divorce, too. They said if your daughter kills themselves, you're more likely to get a divorce.
We're told by lawyers it was best to stay quiet. But they no longer are. They are angry and feel they owe it to Megan to speak out.
Maybe your story could help the welfare of another child.
Absolutely.
That's what we hope.
Gary Tuckman, CNN, O'Fallon, Missouri.
That's where it happened, was O'Fallon, Missouri. Actually, I'm going to be honest to all of you. This does happen quite often. The first one I heard about was Phoebe Prince. Then I heard about Megan Meyer slightly after that, at the end of the Phoebe Prince video. Then I heard about Amanda Todd. I've heard about other stories. But now, like, the one that I focused on the most at first was Amanda Todd. Then Phoebe Prince, and then one day I focused on Megan. I was actually writing a notebook. I was going to write a 3-page video and talk about Megan's story. And but instead, I lost the notebook, and I have no idea where it is. But since I lost it, I was on Megan's video once, and then I thought, why don't I just start making videos now, you know? And now it's more than... Now it's over 20 videos.
...owns the loss of their teenage daughter to suicide. But there is also anger, online outrage over actions they believe led to her death. The parents of a troubled teen say their daughter was driven to her death in part by internet attack.
I'll be back in a minute. Sorry for the inconvenience. I'm back. Sorry for the inconvenience. I just got myself some chips, so sorry if you hear something crunching.
Over MySpace.
Attacks led in part not by other teens, but adults. Fox News' Teresa Woodard is live in Fallon tonight with a story.
That's pathetic. Can't even get adults in trouble now. Have you ever noticed in 2010 people bullied Phoebe Prince got punished? Lori Drew didn't get punished and she should have stayed in jail. Lori Drew deserves to stay in jail for 50 years or for life.
The parent will find difficult to hear, Teresa. Well, here's what we know about this story. A teenager who had battled depression for years did take her own life. We know her mom and dad now claim a neighborhood family, dear friends of theirs, are now responsible for that death. We know that there was no law broken, no real...
How's that not law-breaking?
Crime, but it's all a real tragedy.
She was, you know, our baby, and, you know, we absolutely miss every single second of her.
The smile of a girl about to be 14, about to get her braces off.
She thought life was wonderful.
Not a girl about to...
I think life was actually shaping up for her. Like she had lost more, she had lost 20 pounds, I think. She was in volleyball, she was gonna get her braces taken off. She was 3 weeks shy of her 14th birthday, she picked out the polka dot dress. She gave out invitations for her birthday, you know?
End her life. Megan Meyer had battled depression, had ADD, and was on antidepressants.
I have ADD. I have autism. So I know exactly what Megan went through. Antidepressants don't work for me because last year I took an overdose and almost killed myself. Yes.
But a new school, new friends, and a new MySpace page, strictly monitored by mom and dad, was making life better. Until...
She got this email from this boy named Josh Evans.
Josh was cute. Tina Meyer reluctantly let him have access to her daughter's MySpace account. Friends first, then boyfriend, girlfriend. Then Josh got mean.
Megan gets an email, or a message on her MySpace from Josh saying that... I don't know if I want to be friends with you any longer because I hear you're not nice to your friends.
Over 2 days, more mean messages from him and other people. Megan felt like she was under attack, even from her mom, who was furious Megan was on MySpace without supervision. Tina came home, Megan ran to her room in 20 minutes.
And I just got this horrible feeling in my stomach, and I just took off running upstairs and opened the door and I found her.
Megan hung herself. Weeks later, a friend told the Myers Josh Evans never existed.
Pathetic. Pathetic to make someone kill themselves.
That's the biggest tragedy of the whole thing. An adult did it.
The Myers say a neighborhood family created Josh to see if Megan would say bad things to him about their own daughter. There is a police report where the neighbors admit it.
I believe that it's no different than somebody handing her a loaded gun.
How could you do that to somebody? A child.
The report maroon in 20 minutes.
And I just got this horrible feeling in my stomach, and I just took off running upstairs and opened the door and I found her.
Megan hung herself. Weeks later, a friend told the Myers Josh Evans never existed.
That's the biggest tragedy of the whole.
There's something that he says that kind of rings a kind of bell in your head. It'll ring a bell.
Hey, an adult did it.
The Myers say a neighborhood family created Josh to see if Megan would say bad things to him about their own daughter. There is a police report where the neighbors admit it.
I believe that It's no different than somebody handing her a loaded gun.
How could you do that to somebody? A child.
The report filed by that neighbor accuses the Myers of property damage. The Myers admit when they found out they lost their temper, damaged that family's property, they say they are responsible. But who's responsible for Megan?
We went to...
They smashed the foosball table. I don't blame him for that. I would have done the same thing. That's so fucked up. Not the foosball thing, but doing shit like that to a 13-year-old. She was almost 14, and her and Lori Drew was like 40-something.
The local authorities, the St. Charles County Police Department, the prosecutor, the FBI got involved.
We were hoping and praying that something would come, some justice would come, and we had to keep quiet about it because everybody said keep quiet, keep quiet, keep quiet, and let justice prevail. Well, this is where it's gotten us.
Now, the Myers say they were such dear friends with that family down the street that they had even traveled together and that they were well aware of Megan's battle with depression. Since they can't change their own past, they do want to change the law. They are now lobbying lawmakers, hoping someone would pass some sort of internet regulation. As Megan's father says, anyone who poses as someone online and does something...
Hold on. That's not something friends or families do.
I gotta go refill. Be back. Sorry for the inconvenience again.
Something friends do. Friends wouldn't do that to people. Friends forgive each other.
Something cruel should face some kind of punishment. In Ocala, Missouri, Teresa Woodard, Fox 2 News.
Well, do you want to sound off on this story? You can go to myfoxstl.com, click on the news blogs to tell. Parents are now fighting to have that law changed. Tina and Ron Meyer join us now live with more in their story. First of all, thank you both for coming in. I know it's still very painful for the both of you to relive this tragedy. By the way, just so you know, this happened about a year ago. Megan passed away about a year ago in October. Why now? Why are you coming forward with your story now?
Basically, after it happened, we certainly didn't find out until the weekend of Thanksgiving. Megan passed away on October 17th. We found out the weekend of Thanksgiving that it was the other people that were involved. Previous to that, we thought it was children. Our mission was going to be get the word out that, you know, bullying, we were going to try to do that. Once we found out it was the family, we then went to an attorney. We were told to keep quiet about it. We were told to, the FBI was going to investigate it. So there was a long investigation. After we found out, they did the long investigation. The FBI said that they couldn't do anything. The local police couldn't do anything. Nobody could do anything. It was just kind of, our hearts were broken. I mean, we were just...
Well, I can only imagine. So there are absolutely no legal recourse. Is that right, Ron? What about civil action against this family?
Yeah, criminally, as of right now, there's no recourse. But civil suit, yes, is definitely in order. I mean, we're still currently working with that, so...
Have you had any contact with this family? Have they apologized?
They sent a one-page handwritten letter after we found out, saying that they sympathized with us, that they, you know, understood our grief, but that the information that they knew was far beyond, the information that we found out was far beyond what they knew. Other than that,
so
no.
Was there an apology? Was there an I'm sorry?
No, there was never. There's never been. And, basically, ever since the first day that we found out, there's been no contact from them to us.
And the day you found out, it was another person who came forward who kind of was in the inner circle of all of this, knew this harassment was going on, and all these people kept it quiet. Describe the day when you found out that it was an adult behind all of this.
I think that's the biggest thing that hurt us the most, was that another parent could do this to a child, a 13-year-old girl. A lot of anger from both of us.
Now, I understand both of you are working together. We do want to let our viewers know that you are both now estranged, going through a divorce. I can only imagine the stress on your family. But you are working together to get some laws on the books to stop this from happening to other families. What's your next step? How are you going to get it done?
Well, you know, we've kept quiet for so long, and then all of a sudden this has kind of exploded. My hope is that with the exposure that we can start getting, people in the public to start helping us, you know, the next step. I know that Ron's been working with his attorney. I guess he can speak about that.
Just to contact the local representatives and the people and the politicians in the state of Missouri, because there's actually no laws on the books that govern the internet, per se, for this case.
Even cyber stalking, even harassment, nothing applies?
Well, there is. There's cyber stalking, but Megan's case, nothing fits into it. It wasn't sexual in nature. They couldn't find the last 4 hours of what happened on the computer. The FBI couldn't find it. The Josh Evans MySpace was deleted. So
once you delete it, if there was anything sexual, I think if you delete your MySpace, the message disappears. But if you have a Facebook, the message does not disappear. It just says Facebook user or something, or it still has them, but you can't click their Facebook if they blocked you or something.
Oh, they couldn't fit Megan's case into any specific law.
And Tina, I know you were diligent in policing her MySpace account. And it's not only MySpace, by the way. There are other sites like Facebook, regular email, kids pass notes in school, things like that. You were diligent. What advice can you give parents?
I'm actually going to be honest about MySpace. I wanted a MySpace for years, because I heard about it. So I had like a MySpace that I don't use anymore. It's still active, but I just don't use it anymore. I've been on there a couple times because I tried to look for Megan Myers' memorial page that they had on Facebook, or on excuse me, MySpace. But the only thing I found about her was her MySpace, which is still up, I think it is. Let me go see really quick. Yeah, it's still up. I don't think they felt like deleting it. It says this profile is restricted, and it says only confirmed connection can access this profile. Click connect button to request a connection. And it's unlocked anyway. I'm not sure. I don't think it's been used since a year after Megan killed herself. And there are other people named Megan Meyer, but they're not, yeah.
To them, for other teenagers, those who may be either the target of bullying or, you know.
Yeah, but her MySpace is down now. I would have deleted it, but I would have told Megan to block Josh Evans if I could have.
Even on these pages that are unsupervised.
If I wouldn't known her.
You know, we as parents were so protective of our children. Megan was never allowed to go to the mall. Megan wasn't allowed to. I mean, we watched everything with the MySpace. It was kept private. We are the only ones that had the password. Our computers had passwords. We did every single thing that I thought you could possibly do. Looking back, the only possible way, the thing that I could have done, is the only people that were allowed on it were people that I knew.
That's very hard.
And people you trusted.
Right. It's very hard when they're at that age, though. They have a friend, and then their friend starts talking to them, another friend. They say, oh, Mom, you know, I know this person. That person wants to be added. It's very hard to keep control of that.
And in all of this, Ron, how do you want Megan to be remembered? Because many of us are just learning about her.
She's one of the most caring people in the world. I mean, that's the...
She's like me. One time, I was at KFC, and I was eating dinner. I had like a Double Down and Doublelicious because I had never tried a Doublelicious, but I tried a Double Down. Double Down is two pieces of chicken, cheese, and bacon. And that's what a Doublelicious is, but with bread instead of chicken. It's bread, chicken, cheese, and bacon. And I bought two Doublelicious on my way out and had a cup of water and brought two Doublelicious to a homeless man and a cup of water, and he gave me a hug. And then one time I brought home dinner for a whole family and shared it with my family. I brought a Double Down, a Doublelicious, small mashed potato order, popcorn chicken, lemon cake, and I think I had a drink too, yeah. And I shared it all with my family. I shared my mom a Doublelicious and a Double Down. She likes the Double Down taste because it tastes like chicken cordon bleu. It tastes like cordon bleu, yeah. Well, anyway, that's that part.
Hard thing about this is she would never have done this to anybody else. And
of course Megan wouldn't. If they say she was very caring, she was very caring.
For her to know, she passed away without even knowing that she believes it was this Josh Evans that said the things and didn't know it was this mother down the street. Megan was a bubbly person, great sense of humor, outgoing. That's how I would like her to be remembered, just the pictures that you showed. I mean, there's not a picture in our house that doesn't have her smiling. But yet she hurt bad on the inside.
Well, Ron and Tina, thank you so much for telling your story. We appreciate it. Many parents...
And she's kind of like me, goofy and all that. Yeah. I mean, she had a smile that was so beautiful. And this is my smile. Yeah, it's kind of similar to Megan's, this one. Yeah. I mean, smiling like this for me doesn't work so much. Smiling like this for me works. Yeah. All right, let's continue.
Myself included, of a teenager, it's just touched many of us inside, and we hope you get what you're looking for other families. Right. Thanks for coming in.
Thank you.
We'll be right back. There is a part of Megan Meyer's story you have not yet heard. Megan is the teenager from St. Charles County who committed suicide after being the target of an internet prank. You know about her death, but not about the intense efforts to save her. Fox News' Teresa Woodard is live in St. Charles County tonight to tell us about the heroic efforts to keep Megan alive. Teresa?
Yeah, the night that she took her life, one young man tried desperately to save it. He is a neighbor, a dear family friend, and Megan's little sister knocked on his door, panicking.
She was screaming, "My mom needs you, my mom needs you. Megan's not breathing."
The girl he'd known since birth was close to death, and Blaine Buckles knew how to save her.
I was a lifeguard for 3 years. So I knew what to do. My adrenaline was rushing so much and my heart was pounding. I just didn't have time to think. I mean, I just had to do it.
He did CPR till paramedics came. When they rushed Megan Meyer to the hospital, her heart was beating. Blaine did breathe some life back into her, but it drained the life out of him.
I mean, for hours afterwards, I mean, my whole body was shaking. I didn't know what to do. I didn't know who to go to, anything to do. I mean, I was just lost.
The next day, in the hospital, in her parents' arms, Megan died. The next month, Blaine found out what provoked Megan's suicide. Messages on MySpace from her online boyfriend. One saying the world would be better off without you. But that boyfriend was not real. Megan's family says it was a mom down the street posing as a teenage boy to see if Megan would gossip about her daughter.
There's some mean people out there.
That mom admitted she did it in a police report.
Words hurt. I mean, I've said some pretty mean stuff in my life. Just typing, I mean, you don't actually even have to say it. And I just never realized how mean it was. There's no way I would do that. I mean, I'd call people out if they said something like that. Megan obviously didn't know that this many lives would be touched.
When people insult me, I'm known to fire back. Like, I think Megan fired back when they said fat ass or something. I think she said, I'm not these things, you're these things, or something like that, and then she used bad, vulgar profanity, I think.
And affected by her decision, but definitely a lot of lives have been touched, a lot more than I even thought there would be.
Megan's suicide was 13 months ago. The revelation about the neighbor's involvement came 12 months ago. Everybody kept quiet, hoping police could build a case. But now that there is no case, they want everyone to realize how much words can hurt. Mandy?
Teresa, if all of these people...
I would have been a big brother to Megan and extended a hand to her and to take her out for some ice cream or a milkshake that night so she would have had it. A good rest of the night, you know, and told her, you know, just I'll go to your school tomorrow. I'll tell these people that none of this is true, you know. She went to a different school where she was more happy. But then people, I think, at her new school, at her old school, were telling lies about her to friends at her new school and crap like that, which is not right and not real.
Well, are still living in that same neighborhood. What's it like there now?
It's not just the same neighborhood, it is the same street. And as Blaine described it, it is very tense, especially now that the Myers have gone public.
I can just imagine. Well, we first brought you this story yesterday, and our email absolutely overflowed with messages from you wanting to know more. This is 13-year-old Megan Meyer, a beautiful girl who struggled with her weight and her depression.
A beautiful girl, very beautiful.
And then Megan met a friend on MySpace, a 16-year-old boy named Josh. She was elated, until Josh started sending her cruel and disturbing messages, ultimately telling Megan the world would be better off without her. Megan went upstairs into her bedroom, and she hanged her.
I'd just like to say this, the world is sadder without Megan.
After they buried Megan, her parents learned there was no Josh. Instead, it was the parents of another girl who Megan knew playing a sick prank on a vulnerable young girl. Joining us now for more is Megan's friend and neighbor, Blaine Buckles. Blaine tried to save Megan's life by performing CPR on her. Blaine, thanks so much for being here with us. I know that this is such a disturbing story. Megan's birthday, she would have turned 15 this month. It's a hard time. We spoke with her mother yesterday. Just before we get into the legalities of it, let me ask you, what when you first learned that Megan would...
She would be 23. It's the 21st right now. In about 2 weeks. Because next week is Halloween also, and should be 23 in 2 Fridays from now. It's almost Friday, but she would be 23 2 Fridays from now.
In trouble. Who was it who knocked on your door?
It was her little sister, Allison. She came to the door banging on it, screaming, and my mom went and answered. And she's screaming, my mom needs you, my mom needs you, my sister's not breathing. And I was sitting down eating dinner, and, well, I heard that, so I ran upstairs and I grabbed my lifeguard rescue pack and just ran down there.
And I know you tried to save your friend, and you were able to get her heart beating again. Obviously, ultimately, Megan died, however.
Yes, that's correct. She died the next day in the hospital.
And Blaine, you... Now, just so our viewers understand, the people behind this hoax, the fake Josh, were parents of another girl who was once a friend to Megan. We know the names of those cruel neighbors. We are not revealing it because, unlike those neighbors, we actually are going to have some compassion for their daughter, a compassion they did not have for Megan Meyer. So we don't want to mention their names, but you know who the family is.
If you look up Sarah Drew... And then type up Lori Drew, it'll pop up. Or if you type in Sarah Drew, and Megan Meyer, it'll pop up. It'll show Sarah Drew, Lori Drew, and then this one shows a little picture of Megan on the top, and then it shows Sarah and Lori. And I guess that's Sarah. But then you also have Ashley Grills. All three of these girls are very unattractive. Lori, Sarah, and... yeah. Lori, Sarah, and Ashley are all not attractive compared to Megan.
Describe your reaction when you found out it was adults, it was parents on your block who were doing this to Megan.
Well, not only were they adults, but they live right next door to us. And I was really angry, and I was told I couldn't do anything, just to keep my mouth shut, since they were gonna try to go after them legally. So, until now, I've had to keep...
So, Blaine must have lived 4 or 5 houses down from Megan, because the Drews were 4 houses down, so they must have lived 3 or 5 houses down. 3 to 5, because they were 4, so they lived right next, it was like 3 or 5. 3 or 5 houses for Blaine.
My mouth shut and not saying anything.
Blaine, have you talked to them or to their daughter about what they did to Megan?
No, they've tried to talk to my mom, and I act like they don't exist. I don't even look at them.
This is Megan's gravesite, just for folks looking at the pictures online. And now we're told, Blaine, by the police, that, and this is in Missouri, that nothing could be done, that there are no criminal charges that can be filed. Now, we had a debate yesterday that's still posted on FoxNews.com with our lawyers disagreeing with that. But what your reaction to that statement, Blaine, that no criminal charges can be brought here?
I was pretty mad, but then again, I guess you can change the laws so they won't happen in the future to other kids with problems like Megan had. So, I mean, if there's any good we can get out of it, I think changing the laws would be the best.
Blaine, without giving out the names of the neighbors who did this, what are they like? Apparently it was the mother of a friend of Megan who was really pushing this. What is she like?
Honestly, I didn't talk to her too much, but from what I did, she was real clingy. She, you first meet her and she acted like she was your best friend. And, like, if you had company over and she'd come over, you try to, like, nicely say, okay, I have, like, company over, and she just wouldn't leave you alone.
Damn.
Yeah, and her daughter, has her daughter that...
People like that are annoying, and people who that's just weird.
Woman's daughter, has she shown any remorse for this whole thing?
No, none of them have shown remorse.
I think later that Sarah was devastated in the end.
Because I haven't even seen a tear.
Wow, this is such a disturbing case, Blaine, and I know...
Because she actually cried about it later.
...that you and others are working to have a law change so that charges can result when someone abuses a girl like this online. We appreciate you being here. Good for you for trying to save your friend, but our condolences on the loss of her.
Thank you.
Thanks so much, Blaine. Well, Missouri lawmakers may take action now in the wake of this MySpace hoax. That part of this story tomorrow here on America's Newsroom. Plus, all of our reporting on this story is on FoxNews.com right now. Just click on the America's Newsroom page and you'll see it all. And just so our viewers understand, Bill, the reason these...
Hold up. Sorry for the inconvenience. Oh. Hello? Hello? What time did Mom start work? Yeah, because I tried to call, but she wouldn't answer. Yeah, because we got a ton of milk now that just got delivered. Now we have like 5 cartons of milk and I need her to pick something up. Do you know what time her shift is? What time is her Alright. By the way, I have a little proposal for you. yes, you know, I was talking to a family member. That was my older sister. She's probably one of my favorite family members. She does do a lot for me, too, like my mom does. And she lives about 10 minutes away from me. She used to live in Arizona. I remember that. She moved away for a few months. All right, here we go.
Parents, these neighbor parents did this to Megan Meyer, was according to Megan's mother, who we talked to yesterday, because they...
By the way, I'm not going to give out my name. I'm not going to give out my family member's last name or my family member's name.
Wanted to get information from Megan. They thought Megan was talking about their daughter, and so they concocted this hoax by which they try to gain her confidence and lure information out of her, and then they just turned it to the cruelest of messages to this young, vulnerable girl who had a history of depression, and they knew it.
Online bullies, pay attention to what people are hearing and how they're reacting. Strong, strong lesson from this story. 37 minutes past the hour.
I think it's going to come up. I think this video stops right there.
Laws are already changing in memory of Megan Meyer. The St. Charles teen committed suicide after being the target of an online prank. But was it just cruel or a crime? Tonight, her hometown promises to pass new regulations on internet harassment. But the mayor isn't stopping there.
Fox 2's Teresa Woodard has been following this story and has new details tonight from Garden Prairie. Teresa?
Yeah, the mayor here in Megan's hometown is asking, how is this not a crime? So she's making it one. And she's telling state and federal governments, if you don't think this is a crime, you need to think again.
And to have nothing happen, that's just not right. It's just not right.
In her city of 7,000...
That is actually true. That is not right at all.
Internet harassment is about to be a local crime.
$500 fine is the maximum, with 90 days in jail is the maximum.
Well, the maximum, I would say, is not 90 days in jail. I make it 7,300. That's at least 20 years. I would put 20 years in jail and $1 million fine if I could. Probably $10,000 fine, maybe.
Maximum that I could do. It's something. It's something.
It's the start of something. But the mayor's not done, because Megan Meyer's memory is haunting her. Megan committed suicide after the boy she thought was her online boyfriend posted mean messages on MySpace.
To all you out there, if you're gonna do online dating, don't. I've done it once, and it screwed my life up. I was on with this bitch from Pennsylvania. I'm 3,000 miles away from her. I'm gonna find this out. Here's one. Pennsylvania is 38 hours driving to there by bus, I don't think. By walking, it's 832 hours. So basically, almost 35 days to get there on feet. And I don't know who would want to walk all the way. Bicycling is only 238 hours. That'd be like almost 10 days. But, you know. And that's for people who can pedal, like Lance Armstrong, maybe.
Now, Megan's family claims a mom down the street created that boyfriend. They say their daughter, who struggled with depression, was played on by an adult.
An adult?
That adult admitted it. In a police report, she says she did create the virtual boyfriend. He was a fake. He never existed. But she faces no charges because there was no crime. So the mayor's making it a crime and telling lawmakers,
you all need to look at this.
The reality is that this is a way bigger problem than what's happening in the state of Missouri.
The lawmakers are listening, but are not convinced it will ever be possible for a state to police the internet.
We have to look at what's within our control, what we can fix and what we can't fix.
We may be a small city, but I'm here to tell you, if I don't hear some response out of them, that I am going to keep screaming until I get something out of them. Because if I can do it, they certainly can do it.
Darden Prairie's Board of Aldermen meet next Wednesday. That's when they're expected to pass this ordinance, making internet harassment a Class B misdemeanor in this city. That's as much as they could do. They will also pass resolutions encouraging the state and federal governments to take a look at this. No matter what happens, any law that is passed cannot apply to Megan's case. Light of Darden Prairie.
A teen commits suicide after being targeted by an online attack, but those who instigated it face no criminal charges for the...
Give me a minute. Sorry for the inconvenience once again. I need to make a call. Sorry for the inconvenience. Sorry I'm getting up so much, but I've been having to pause the video a lot, and I don't mean to.
The online outrage. Or could they? Fox 2 brought you this story last night, and since then, outrage from people wanting justice for Megan Myers' family.
And now there is a slight chance justice might come. Fox 2's Teresa Woodard has more details and word that prosecutors might, and we stress might, still be able to build a case. Teresa?
Yeah, Mandy, we don't want to give anybody any false hope, but the St. Charles County prosecutor is saying, hold on a minute, everybody. He has yet to review this entire case. When he does, he says he's pretty convinced he will agree with everybody that what happened was cruel, not criminal. But he's not ready to say that for sure just yet.
I think every parent and a man, husband, father tells himself nobody's ever going to hurt my family. And it happened.
The Myers are not just hurt, they are ruined. Megan is gone. Ron and Tina are divorcing. Their daughter took her own life, but they believe there's someone behind it.
She did do what she did, but she had help to push her to do that, which is indescribable to me.
In a police report, a family down the street admits they were involved. Megan was almost 14. She met Josh Evans on MySpace. They became online friends, but suddenly his messages turned...
I actually have to put a sign up on my door because some people come into my... Because my mom's at work and I have to put this up so she doesn't come into my room. Get a lot out, and this video is even longer. It's gonna take a very long time. It's probably gonna take at least 2 to 3 hours to finish, and I'm so sorry that this is gonna be so long.
Mean. He began posting nasty things about Megan. The worst, according to the Myers. Josh said the world would be better off without you. It was the final message Megan.
I think have a shitty rest of your life is worse.
Saw. she hung herself. Weeks later, the Myers were told Josh wasn't real. That family down the street, adults, made him up to see if Megan would gossip to him about their daughter.
They knew she'd had depression. They knew she had ADD. They knew the medication she was on. They've known this for years.
That police report was filed because the Myers damaged that family's property. But it's a report the prosecutor never saw.
Me, personally, I've never seen anything on this case.
He wants to see all the evidence now. From what he's heard, though, he knows hearts are broken. He doesn't think laws work.
It's just a system that isn't regulated much, and it's difficult to regulate it. It's just so easy to just type something out, send it out there, and not know what the consequence of that message is going to be. Can we police the entire thing? I don't know.
So what about MySpace? Could the website bear any responsibility? Well, a couple of different law school professors say the answer is no. They say that technology long ago passed up the Constitution, and they say when it comes to the Internet, the laws are simply a mess. And that's why Megan's family wants a new law. Live in St. Charles, Teresa Woodard, Fox 2 News.
Well, plenty of viewers have sounded off on this story, and so can you. Just head over to myfoxstl.com and go to our news blog.
This morning, a cautionary tale for parents out there. A 13-year-old girl found herself in the middle of a cruel cyber hoax, and her parents say it led to their daughter's suicide. Now, more than a year after Megan Myers' death, her parents are pushing for measures to protect other children.
At 13 years old, Megan Meyer was like many teenagers. She struggled with low self-esteem, but her family says she was looking forward to getting her braces off, enjoying life in the suburbs of St. Louis, and excited about a new friend she met through the social networking site MySpace.com.
She got this email from this boy named Josh Evans.
Josh claimed to be a 16-year-old boy who lived nearby and was homeschooled, but the relationship would quickly turn hurtful as conversation turned to insult.
Megan gets an email or a message on her MySpace from Josh saying that, "I don't know if I want to be friends with you any longer because I hear you're not nice to your friends."
Megan was devastated. The next day, after more exchanges, her mother found her in her bedroom closet. She had hanged herself. Weeks later, her parents learned that Josh never existed. He was created by the mother of one of Megan's former friends down the street.
That's the biggest tragedy of the whole thing. An adult did it.
It's a bizarre twist to the very common world of cyberbullying. Nearly half of teenagers report they've been the victim of cyber attacks, from text messaging to emailing, even websites dedicated solely to harassment.
When emotionally vulnerable young people get online, they can be very easily manipulated.
Megan's parents don't believe her tormentors meant for her to commit suicide, but they say the harassment drove her to the edge.
And joining us now are Megan's parents, Tina Meyer and Ron Meyer. Good morning.
Actually, speaking of that, I don't think they meant for Megan to kill herself.
To you, first of all, our condolences, obviously, for the loss of your daughter. And I know it's difficult to talk about all this. We hear about kids cyberbullying, bullying each other online, but this was a parent bullying your daughter, pretending to be someone else. Why would she do that?
We don't know. How do you get in the mind of somebody that you just have no idea? We have no answer for that.
Do you think her daughter put her up to it and wanted to know more about your daughter? Or?
No.
Everything that we found out so far, it was the sole idea of the mother.
Do you hold her responsible for the death of your daughter?
I do.
Absolutely.
Yes, I believe they were the ones that took her to the edge of the cliff and gave her the nudge to go over.
Did you have any idea at any point, Tina, that this was not a 16-year-old boy named Josh that your daughter was conversing with? Any red flags?
There were red flags, but they weren't big enough. There were enough red flags where I did make a call to the local police department to find out how can you find if a MySpace account is real or not. There's no real way.
I think all you have to do is talk to a computer geek and find out where the IP address is from. Because sometimes they can track something.
You know, I certainly had that gut feeling, But it wasn't, again, it wasn't enough to, it was just that nervous mom feeling.
And as you say, there's no way to prove. this. So I wonder, what do you think can be done to stop this from happening again to someone else? Is there any way to stop someone from putting a
profile? That's Chewy! Yeah.
That's fake.
I wish that there were regulations with these companies that are out there that put out these type of forums. There's got to be something. I mean, children are able to, no matter whether they're 8, 9, 10, they're adults, they can get on there and put, they can be whoever they want to be.
I know one girl who messaged my friend who's 23 and she's only 12 and she said she was 15, I think. And she made herself a fake Facebook and then one lady turned that into the police about him and he blocked the daughter and then deleted all the messages they ever shared.
There's some sort of regulations out there to be able to protect children. Parents can only be in so many places at so many times. And children do not understand the risks.
We're running out of time. I'm sorry. Ron, is there a quick lesson, though, for other parents?
I'd just like to say is don't take anything for granted and be as watchful as you can be and proactive in the involvement with your children on the Internet.
Right. Well, good luck in your fight to make some changes. Tina Meyer, Ron Meyer, we thank you for your time.
NBC News In Depth tonight, an internet hoax and its terrible consequences. The parents of a teenage girl who took her own life in a St. Louis suburb are now going public with her story as a cautionary tale for other parents. Here's NBC's George Lewis.
Megan had asked if she could have a MySpace for her 14th birthday.
When Megan...
Maybe she wanted... You know, MySpace is... what a lot of kids were in love with back then.
I joined the 70 million users of the popular online hangout, MySpace.com. Her parents said they took precautions, insisting that Megan only use the computer under their supervision.
We were protecting her as much as possible. There was nothing that could have harmed her, is what we felt.
Then, Megan, who had struggled with weight problems and depression, met someone online. He said his name was Josh Evans. He was 16 and attracted to her.
To her, it was like, whoa, you know, had never experienced this.
But a year ago, Josh abruptly turned on Megan.
Megan received an email from Josh stating, "I don't know if I want to be friends with you any longer because I heard you're not a very nice friend."
Then Megan began receiving insulting messages from other people.
Bulletins went out calling her names, saying Megan's fat.
She just said that everybody's being mean to me.
They said stuff like, "Megan Meyer's a fat ass, Megan Meyer's a whore, slut, you freak," and all that shit.
Don't understand it, why they're saying these horrible things about me. I just told her, "It'll be okay, Meg."
But it wasn't okay. 20 minutes later, in Megan's bedroom, Tina screamed when she discovered her daughter had hung herself.
It said, "We love you, Meg Bow." Right there. I just can't stand whenever anyone does this to a girl who has ADD and to a girl who has depression.
I just stopped what I was doing and ran up there as fast as I could, and that's when she was hanged in the closet.
Some months later, another shock. The Meyers discovered there was no boy named Josh, that it was all a hoax. A neighbor tipped them that the whole thing was cooked up by the parents of one of Megan's former girlfriends. The idea to see if Megan was saying nasty things about their daughter online.
I feel that they led to her taking her life.
Despicable. Disgusting. There's not enough horrible words to describe it.
The family that invented Josh lives just down the street from the Meyers. There's a question whether they broke a new federal law prohibiting internet harassment.
This was done just to hurt a child. And when adults act like children,
We need to treat them like criminals.
Now, Megan's mom and dad hope to warn other parents so that they don't have to go through the same heartbreaking experience. George Lewis, NBC News, Los Angeles.
Tina and Ron Meyer are Megan's parents. Mr. and Mrs. Meyer, good morning to both of you and our condolences to you.
Good morning.
It's been almost a year since Megan's death, and now you're coming forward to speak out about this. Why come forward now?
Well, we had had, after Megan had passed away, it was about 5 weeks until we found out that it was not just the boy, it was actually a family. We had hired attorneys, and then the attorneys had suggested that we keep it quiet. The FBI did an investigation, and they suggested we keep it quiet also. During that investigation, obviously, we were hopeful that something was going to be done criminally, and that took a while. Once everything was exhausted on that side, and they came to us and said, listen, there's nothing that we can do. It doesn't fit into any law. We just were devastated. And from that point, just kind of needed to take a little bit of a break.
I'll go back into some of the details in a second, Mr. Meyer, but does it seem as if you've exhausted any legal remedy for this? I mean, we heard about it, possibly a new federal law that covers harassment online. Is this situation, does this not fall under that law?
We're hopeful for that. We're still continuing on with the fight on the criminal and on the civil side as of right now as we speak.
You two are parents who, as we heard in the piece, did from time to time monitor Megan's communications online. So can you explain to other parents who are watching how this might have gotten out of hand, how this may have developed so quickly?
Well, it wasn't even time to time. I mean, it was monitored highly. Megan was not allowed to get online. We had the password. Megan couldn't even sign on without us. We had to be in the room. So this was highly monitored. The only thing that we can suggest is that parents just take a closer look at what their kids are doing. And kids take a step and look at what they're doing also. I mean, it is very scary. We were fighting against adults.
Well, Mrs. Meyer, let me go back to that. If you were monitoring her communications then, as you say, on a daily basis, what were you saying to her when she first started to communicate with this young man, Josh, that she thought was just a nice guy expressing interest in her? Did you warn her about getting her hopes up or that she might be let down by this young man she'd never met?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, that was always the talk of, you know, Megan, come on, we don't even know this person, you know, let's not get too excited. And she would say, oh, Mom, you don't understand, you know. And, you know, so I did talk to her daily about that. But again, children at this age, they don't think that.
And there's something, Mr. Meyer, that somewhat haunts me as I read the script here and read the information, that when it comes right down to it, Megan died never knowing that this young man didn't exist.
Absolutely. She still believes that it was Josh Evans. I mean, as you said, we didn't find that out till about 6 weeks later, that it was the parents down the street from our house.
So what would you say? Two questions real quickly. Have you had any contact, any conversations with the parents, the neighbors who were behind this? What have they said? Have they offered apologies, anything like that?
They've absolutely offered no apologies. They've sent us a letter in the mail, basically saying that they might feel a little bit of responsibility, but they don't feel no guilt or remorse or anything for what they did.
And Mrs. Meyer, what?
I ran into her.
Go ahead.
I ran into her this past week after the story ran in the local paper, and she asked me to stop doing all of this. And I told her that we would not stop, that we were going to continue for justice for Megan because they knew what they did.
So is there one piece of advice you can offer to other parents?
I feel to continue to monitor your children, take an extra step, ask the questions, look at their computers, see what they're doing, and for kids to please take those extra steps and don't trust anybody online that you do not know is your true friend.
Tina and Ron Meyer. Mr. and Mrs. Meyer, again, our condolences, and we thank you for sharing your story and Megan's story with us this morning.
Thank you.
Time now for Big Justice, and a mother and father are trying to seek justice for their young daughter's suicide. Fox News has been following the story of a 13-year-old who hanged herself in a closet after she was seduced and then rejected by a fictitious 16-year-old boy online. The distraught teen died without ever knowing that the boy who she thought rejected her was really a family down the street playing a twisted and cruel hoax on her.
And now her distraught parents are trying to get the family to pay, stepping up their efforts today to get lawmakers to pay attention to their case. Big Story correspondent Douglas Kennedy spoke to the little girl, Megan's mother, today. He's with us now, Douglas.
Yeah, John and Heather. Tina Myers says she tried to keep her daughter off the internet because she says you never know who you're talking to and what their motives are. Now she fears even if you do know, there may be nothing you can do about it. When their daughter died, Ron and Tina Meyer turned to everyone they could think of for justice.
We went to the local authorities, the St. Charles County Police Department, the prosecutor.
Yeah, it takes a lot to probably... This is going to be another hour on this video. Sorry for making the video so long, but this is all bunched up, but... They said that they had to go everywhere.
The FBI got involved.
But it's been a year since their 13-year-old hung herself, and no one has taken action. Tina Meyer says she's now considering a civil suit.
What would be the basis of the civil suit?
Obviously for all the damages that have been done to our family, to our daughter, every single thing that...
Yeah, this one's on the phone.
...has been done.
The Myers say Megan was the victim of a cruel online hoax perpetrated by the parents of Megan's former friend, a neighbor who lives just up the street in Darden Prairie, Missouri.
She got this email from this boy named Josh Evans.
In fact, in the month before she died, Megan had been involved in an intense online romance with Josh Evans. Only Evans was a fiction, made up by the neighbors who, according to a police report, wanted revenge on Megan for talking trash about their daughter at school. Megan's mother says 20 minutes before Megan killed herself, the neighbors once again pretended to be Josh.
I think that Megan was friends with her from the 4th grade to 7th grade. It was like 4th, 5th, 6th, and then in 7th they were like breaking off friendship, coming back, breaking off, off and on, and then just broke off completely. Because I think she called Sarah Drew a lesbian or something.
This time sending Megan into a suicidal spiral.
Megan gets an email or a message on her MySpace from Josh saying that, I don't know if I want to be friends with you any longer because I hear you're not nice to your friends.
She did do what she did, but she had help to push her to do that, which is indescribable to me.
The problem for the Myers is that laws regarding online harassment are few and far between. Tina says she's hoping a new law regarding internet stalking may help them.
Annoying people anonymously over the internet is now a federal crime.
In 2006, President Bush signed the Violence Against Women Act of 2005. According to a section of the act, anyone who uses the internet anonymously with intent to annoy, abuse, threaten, or harass another person can be tried for violating the federal telecommunications law and faces fines or jail.
And this is something that we're hoping that will be able to be placed against the people because it was put into effect prior to my daughter taking her own life.
Meyer says she has forwarded a copy of the law to a local prosecutor. She says she also plans to forward it to the FBI by tomorrow morning. She says if no one thinks the law applies to her case, John and Heather, she is going to work to change that law.
Hey, Douglas, the parents who did this said a word?
They have said nothing, except to the police who they admitted that they were trying to...
It.
Yeah.
harasser.
And they say their reason for doing this, and we'll bring in Joe in just a second, but their reason for doing this was, A, to find out what their daughter, what this girl was writing about.
They have a 13-year-old daughter, and they were friends at one point.
But they also really wanted to mess with her. They really wanted to hurt this little girl.
This is the classic overprotective 2007 parents who just go way too far.
No, there's no disputing an injustice was done to this beautiful little girl, but did the family who bullied her online actually commit a crime? Maybe not in the eyes of the law, but as Douglas just said, her family may try to get the laws changed.
People bully and prank each other all the time, but should they be held legally responsible if the prank pushes someone to suicide? What about when the victim is a child and the victimizer is an adult, like in this case? Douglas is going to stay with us, but let's bring in our legal guest, criminal defense attorney Joe Tacopina. Okay, so the perpetrator here is the adult. What recourse do the parents of this young deceased girl have?
You know, putting pressure on prosecutors certainly is one, raising the public awareness of things like this. I mean, this is vile. There's no ifs, ands, or buts about it. The parents who did this are not the classic protective five of five kids. You couldn't catch me in a million years thinking about spending time to torture another kid. I'd pick up the phone and speak to the parent. But this is vile. What they did here, but on the other five kids, that's quite a bit.
You know, I want three daughters.
See, squirrel have.
You know, putting pressure on prosecutors certainly is one, raising the public awareness of things like this. I mean, this is vile. There's no ifs, ands, or buts about it. The parents who did this are not the classic protective five of five kids. You couldn't catch me in a million years thinking about spending time to torture another kid. I'd pick up the phone and maybe speak to the parent. But this is vile. What they did here, but on the other hand, does it rise to the level of criminality? Is there even an actionable civil claim? Probably not, because there is something that us lawyers get bogged down with called causation.
Before you go to causation, mm-hmm. I mean, this online fraud leads to a suicide. Why shouldn't people look at it as a murder?
Well, if it leads to a suicide, I mean, again, I can't say, you can't ask me a question and say, before we go to causation, let's ask the question.
Well, but
that is causation.
But
I mean,
Douglas,
how do you know
about
it leads to the murder? I mean, this girl was, don't forget, she had bouts of depression prior to any of this going on. She had attention deficit disorder, weight problems that apparently caused her to be depressed.
You're a lawyer, you're a parent, let's just say this happened to you. What would you be doing?
Oh, everything that these parents are doing, probably more, going out there, seeking every ounce of justice.
If I had a daughter, and someone did that to my daughter, what do you think I would do? I would go absolutely apeshit.
You know, she's not going to have very much luck with the local sheriff's office. He says there's no law that applies to it. Where she may have some luck is with the feds. I spoke with the U.S. attorney in Washington State who says she prosecuted a case very similar to this in 2003, where an ex-boyfriend was harassing his ex-girlfriend and sending false emails to her work and so on and so forth. And he went to jail.
What stuns me is that the law enforcement doesn't know about this, and she's got to bring in the feds. Anyway, guys, we'll stay on this. Thanks.
Good morning, everyone. After an exhaustive investigation, it has now been announced there will be no charges filed in the Megan Meyer case.
In a news conference that just wrapped up, St. Charles County Prosecutor Jack Banas says what happened in this case did not violate any law that prosecutors can prove. Fox News' Sean Lindsay is live in St. Charles with the details. Sean?
Good morning, April and Kevin. This is a tragedy. There is no question about that. But the prosecutor says that what happened in the days before Megan Meyer killed herself involved a number of conversations online between teenage girls, and those girls never imagined that this would happen, that she would kill herself. Banna says the intent of creating the fake MySpace account was to find out what Megan was saying about a friend. Banna says the mother of that friend, Mrs. Drew, knew about the account and knew about Megan's fragile mental state, but her role in many of the communications is disputed, including the final communication that said the world would be a lot better without Megan.
I think the one who said that was Ashley Grills.
And that came from an 18-year-old employee of Mrs. Drew's who is now hospitalized for psychiatric problems. She herself may be suicidal as a result of her involvement in this terrible tragedy. Megan Meyer killed herself after reading the message that she believed came from Josh. Josh never existed, but Megan believed he was her friend. Banna says this case does not meet Missouri's harassment, stalking, or child endangerment laws. He says the purpose of the MySpace account...
I know why I know why it was done. This is the gist I know. The reason Ashley Grill said the world would be a better place without you is because Megan, or because she wanted to be done with torturing, to be done with faking a relationship with Megan. But with all of them involved, they all should be shamed and they all should show remorse. You don't just do this shit. You apologize if you did this fucking shit. It's fucked up. And Megan's a beautiful girl.
It was not to disturb or frighten Megan, which is necessary to prove under Missouri law.
Their purpose was never to cause her emotional harassment. It's that we can prove. There's a difference between what people think or what we may believe the reason was that they created this. It's what we can prove.
Now, Banna says that there has been plenty of retaliation against the family involved with the creation of that MySpace account. Ironically, much of what has happened to them may actually be prosecutable as harassment. He says that there have been things that have been said and done online. Their house has been hit with paintballs. Windows have been broken and charges will be filed in at least one instance.
Listen
against the family involved with the creation of that MySpace account. Ironically, much of what has happened to them may actually be prosecutable as harassment. He says that there have been things that have been said and done online. Their house has been hit with paintballs. Windows have been broken and charges will be filed in at least one instance.
Sometimes people egg people's houses. Justin Bieber's known to do that. I don't like that kid at all.
Because we can't prosecute somebody, it certainly doesn't justify violating the law. We live in this country by the rule of law. We have to. Otherwise, we lose our civility.
Now, Banna says there are certainly some loopholes in state laws that he believes need to be addressed. But this case involved so many people, so much, he said, she said, that even if there were an internet harassment law in place, he doesn't necessarily know if this case could be prosecutable under that law. He does want the state to go ahead and look into those things. But again, the circumstances of this case, just so bizarre and involving so many people, all of which very difficult to prove under the law. Live in St. Charles, I'm Sean Lindsay, Fox 2 News.
No charges will be filed in the case of a young girl who killed herself after being harassed online. The St. Charles County prosecutor in Missouri have been investigating whether...
They need to actually charge Lori Drew. This is fucked up.
Any laws were broken when cyberbullying apparently led to the suicide of 13-year-old Megan Meyer. The teen thought she was falling for a 16-year-old boy online. Instead, he was apparently made up by another 13-year-old girl, her mother, and an older teen. Joining us now, MSNBC senior legal analyst and former Connecticut state prosecutor Susan Filan. Do you think the prosecutor had anywhere else to go with this?
I think he sounded like such a conscientious, responsible person that if he did, he would have. But I think he felt that his hands were tied. It's just counterintuitive to me, though, that an adult can engage in this kind of behavior that leads to the suicide of a young girl and not be held accountable. It seems to me that either there are laws on the books that could have applied or there have to be. We've got to enact some.
Yeah, well, let's talk about there should be something on the books. I mean, is there something you can think of or you can see that might have been applicable?
Harassment, stalking, criminal impersonation, reckless endangerment. I mean, it just seems to me that perhaps the prosecutor didn't want to take that cyber leap in the courtroom and try to convince a jury that what could have been innocent, in other words, making up a personality, posing as somebody else, pretending to court them and then be mean to them, isn't normally criminal behavior. But there are other aspects to this case, which is simply that it's a mom, it's a grown-up, it's an adult who could have and should have known the consequences of her behavior. The mom apparently knew that this young girl was taking certain kinds of prescription medicines, which would, I think, suggest some kind of vulnerability that perhaps isn't in any other teen. I just can't see how she gets away with it.
And let me ask you finally, we've talked about this before, how sometimes, especially with new technology, it takes a tragedy
for new laws to be enacted. Do you think that other localities, perhaps even states, will do what her town did, which is at least make this a misdemeanor in some way directly prosecutable?
I think so. The trick, though, is to make sure that it doesn't violate the First Amendment free speech, that it isn't overly vague so that it's unconstitutional, unenforceable, and so that it isn't basically
You do have freedom of speech, and that's my favorite, rules, laws of America is freedom of speech. But what you need to do is you shouldn't abuse it.
Legislating a law that says it's not okay to be mean. It's illegal to be mean. We can't regulate conduct, although it would be nice if we could. It's got to be something more than that. It's got to be something that you do something like this, someone dies, you're responsible.
Okay, Susan, thanks.
You bet.
When you heard no one would be charged in connection with your daughter's suicide, how did you feel?
Well, I was certainly...
I think she's on the phone right now.
Disappointed, and...
And she had these pictures of Megan. I've seen this picture before. I don't know if you can, if you'll be able to see this one clearly. It's a picture of Megan wearing a tiara and a picture of Megan with a smile. Megan wasn't just a smiley, bubbly girl. She was also very goofy, judging to the pictures that she took and what Tina said, but she was also very bubbly and very smiley, like me.
You know, I was angered at first. I was, you know, when he first told me on Friday afternoon, we had about a 3-hour meeting, and in the beginning, you know, I just certainly couldn't understand it, and we went through line by line the statutes and the three different areas of where he thought possibly could have been. Certainly couldn't understand it, and we went through line by line the statutes and the three different areas of where he thought possibly could have been some criminal prosecution. When we went through that, it certainly, while I wasn't happy about it, it made sense where he was not going to be able to prosecute based upon the statutes that were available.
I know there is actually a new law in your community which makes this kind of bullying a misdemeanor. Is that enough for you at this point? Is that justice for your daughter?
Absolutely not. It is certainly, you know, we were absolutely thrilled that there was such quick action with the mayor in our city, because it certainly just gave us that extra step that somebody at least listened to us. But it is absolutely not enough.
And since the last login on Megan's MySpace was...
Because it certainly just gave us that extra step that somebody at least listened to us.
Was November 16th,
2007. But it is absolutely
yes.
Not enough. Not even close.
And that's when she would have been 16. That was like 7 years ago. I'm almost 10 months older than Megan, about.
And the mayor also agreed with that, too. We are absolutely 100% moving forward with getting laws, and laws that are not going to have the cracks, because that's the problem, is when you go line for line with these statutes, if there's, you know...
There's Ron Meyer. It shows they must have been doing a candlelight thing for Megan. They did the same thing with Phoebe Prince, I think.
Everything is with the intent. Well, because the original intent...
Oh, hold on.
Because it certainly just gave us that extra step that we have to make sure with lawmakers that we... The problem.
Because that's a candlelight right now.
Is when you go line...
And here are people, it looks like, talking for Megan.
Line with these...
There's Ron.
Statutes. If there's, you know, everything is with the intent.
Well, and there's Tina. And I wonder if that's Allison, because Allison's Megan's little sister. And in The Web of Lies, of course, she and Tina are going to cry, I bet, because she said she remembered walking upstairs and seeing her sister. Or she remembered walking upstairs and seeing her sister, and she cried at that and cried like two more times, like seeing her mom scream horrible, and it was horrible, and it was pouring rain. And then Tina cried about that too, and Tina went through a lot of depression from that.
Because the original intent of this MySpace was stated that the intent was to find out if my daughter was speaking about her daughter. Well, that throws out that part of it. So it's very, very specific. And we have to make sure with lawmakers that we, with now the internet being so, you know, growing so fast, and this is not going to be something that's going to just die down. This is something that...
I've just been coughing.
...is going to be forever growing.
And that is why it's so important to raise awareness about it. We're getting a little short on time, but I'm curious, this other family, the other mother, you all still live in the same community. Has she apologized to you?
No, she hasn't, and really it's not something that I even want from her.
Do you ever see her, even at the grocery store?
I had seen her about 2 weeks ago, right after the story broke, and she asked me to just stop all of this, and I told her that we would never stop, that we will continue on every day. And an apology from her really means absolutely nothing to me.
Is there anything that ever would make you feel as if justice had been served for Megan?
You know, I really, even with today, you know, decision, I did not feel that was a defeat at all. You know, Megan is with us every single day and certainly carries me every day. This only...
Megan's still with us in here. She's always in our hearts. She's not dead. Your body dies, you live on. That's what Jesus always said. Jesus said there's no such thing as death.
Need more power to be able to stand
and
up and say,
she's,
you know,
on the phone and says Tina Meyer found her daughter hanging in closet.
Laws absolutely 100% need to be changed. And this is also giving me the power to be able to get into the schools with children, giving them education on cyberbullying. And, you know, again, it's not a defeat. This is just one more step that gives me, you know, the where I need to go in order to continue Megan's fight.
Tina Meyer, I wish you the best of luck with that. Thanks for your time.
Thank you.
That is Megan Meyer, who at 13 years old killed herself after someone she met on her MySpace page turned against her. Megan thought she was talking to a 16-year-old boy, a boy who liked her. As we know, the boy never existed. He was created by a neighbor, a woman, a mother, who wanted to find out...
The first story that I put up, the first video that was on this with the news story is by the same company, CNN.
Megan and her daughter were fighting. Tina Meyer is the mother of Megan. She joins me now from St. Louis. Tina, I'm so sorry for your loss.
Thank you.
What went through your mind when you heard the prosecutor say there would be no criminal charges filed?
Well, I met with him on Friday, and we went over this for 3 hours. And, you know, when I first spoke with him, I was extremely angry and disappointed. And I certainly couldn't understand why there could not be criminal charges when I felt that what she had done was absolutely criminal. And once we went through the statutes line by line and what he had to work with, unfortunately, again, there just is not, the law just does not work with what has happened. When you look at the intent and when you look at what he has to work with, unfortunately, it's not there. I'm sorry.
And now there seems to be some, I mean, this mother... what is going through her mind, or what was going through her mind, I can't even begin to understand, but she apparently hired somebody, an 18-year-old girl, to set up this page, and I guess her own daughter contributed to this page as well. Who do you hold responsible?
I absolutely hold the mother responsible, and the father. The father knew what was going on also.
The father should have said, this isn't right, don't do it, or something.
And, you know, in the beginning, we've always known that the mother probably was not the one who actually typed the MySpace. She had no idea how to do this. And so we've always known that it was probably the 18-year-old employee and the 13-year-old daughter who physically typed it. And she was probably the one who sat there and, you know, knew what was going on. Bottom line is, she was the adult. She knew my daughter and had known us for years, knew that she was on medication. If you're an adult and you're allowing this to go on,
She stated that she also stood behind her daughter when she typed messages to my daughter. If you're going to allow that to go on, you absolutely should be charged with criminal charges. We can't know what the outcome of things are. To say that she did not intentionally...
I'm going to be quite honest with you. I didn't know that Facebook... I didn't know how to use YouTube completely. I didn't know how to use MySpace completely. I didn't know how to use Facebook at first. It was just... I left my Facebook blank for about 3 months until I started using it. One time, I'm actually going to be honest. I was on Facebook one night, or I actually was on YouTube at my high school a long time ago when I was 16. And I thought YouTube sent me an email and asked, did you go to the AC/DC concert at the Dome? So I messaged them back and said, yes, I did. It was awesome. But someone actually asked me that on my YouTube account. Yeah, I saw an AC... Yeah, I was at an AC/DC concert. That's where I got that poster from. I've had that poster. For 7 years now.
I think that my daughter was going to commit suicide. I agree with that. I don't think that they went into this deciding, you know what, your daughter's going to commit suicide and that's what we want to do. I think that they intentionally made this MySpace account. I think that it was one of those things. She wanted to see if my daughter was talking about her daughter. But you're playing with a child.
It's completely reckless. I mean, there's no doubt about it.
Absolutely.
What do you, I mean, where do you go now? I mean, do you try to go after them civilly? What is the next step?
Well, we certainly haven't closed any doors as far as a civil...
1 minute, sorry for the inconvenience. Oh, it's Eddie. Hello? Hello, how are you?
Not too bad. I did have a question for you. So what do you want to hang out all these days if you can? Thank you.
Sorry for the inconvenience. I was talking to my mentor, Eddie. I just had to ask him a few questions, but I'm back again.
But, you know, my biggest thing is, regardless, I don't feel this is a defeat. To me, it is one step further that we're going to go. We have to work with lawmakers. And the internet has moved so quickly, and the laws have not. We have got to work with lawmakers to get the laws in place to work with what the internet has. This is not going to be anything that's going to stop anytime soon.
And you want schools to address this issue, too?
Oh, absolutely. We've got to get into the schools. We've got to address cyberbullying with the children, with parents, with educators.
Do people take bullying seriously enough, especially cyberbullying?
Oh, absolutely not. The children are cyberbullied all day long. It's not just in school where we used to get bullied. Now it's in school, you go home, you get cyberbullied there, and it goes out to hundreds and hundreds of kids. And children, there's no stopping point. So we have to address it, absolutely.
Tomorrow, the decision not to file criminal charges in that case of the internet hoax that led to a young girl's suicide. NBC's Peter Alexander has the details.
As cruel as the online messages 13-year-old Megan Meyer received may have been, as painful the terrible result, the county prosecutor says there's no evidence of child endangerment, stalking, or any other crime. Earlier this morning, prosecutor Jack Banas spoke to the Today Show.
That still would not amount to harassment through stalking because it's only one conversation, only one course of conduct, and our law requires that it be repeated, meaning more than once.
Megan's parents say they're disappointed, but not surprised.
If you have to go by the law, which is what the court system does, your hands are tied.
The sad story began last year when Megan, who had a history of depression, was ecstatic to meet 16-year-old Josh Evans on MySpace.com, never knowing he wasn't real. Prosecutors say the fake MySpace page was created by an 18-year-old woman who worked for one of the Myers' neighbors, Lori Drew. The sole purpose? Not to bully Megan, but to find out what she'd been saying about Drew's 13-year-old daughter. At best, prosecutors say Drew knew about the page. At worst, she instigated it and told her daughter what to write.
And the sole purpose by all parties that were involved in this has been to find out what Megan was saying about this 13-year-old daughter of Mrs. Drew.
Josh first showered Megan with compliments. Then a few weeks later, began post...
First it was like, your eyes are beautiful, lucky me, lucky you, because you were my number one. You're my beautiful princess.
...insults about her online. It's unclear exactly who wrote what. The final note read, "This world would be a better place without you." A short time later...
This world is a sadder place without Megan.
Megan hanged herself. Despite all the outrage, criminal law attorneys say the prosecutor had no choice.
This is still relatively new technology, and it takes a while for the law to catch up with technology.
Lori Drew's teenage employee has been hospitalized for psychiatric care. The Drew family is now the target of harassing calls and sinister threats. A poorly conceived hoax blamed for one teenage girl's death and for...
It says rotten neighbor or something.
...dividing an entire small town community. For today, Peter Alexander, NBC News, Los Angeles.
We have reaction from both sides this morning. Megan's parents, Tina and Ron Meyer, in O'Fallon, Missouri this morning. We'll speak to them in a moment. But first, a Today exclusive, Jim Briscoe, Lori Drew's attorney, is with us. This is the first time anyone has spoken publicly on Mrs. Drew's behalf. Jim, good morning. Nice to have you here.
Thanks for
having me. Her reaction to the fact that DA is not going to press charges?
Well, certainly she's happy with that decision, and we were confident that was going to be the case all along once the facts came out and once the prosecutor had a chance to look at all the facts.
So much has been said and written about Lori Drew over the course of the last month or so. Why hasn't she come forward to tell her side of the story?
Well, there was an investigation going on, and she did not want to interfere with that investigation. We were in contact at times with the prosecutors, and they were asking her questions. She cooperated fully, and she told them what she knew about the case and wanted to give them a chance to talk to all the witnesses.
You've heard what's been said, that either she instigated this hoax, that she created this hoax, that she carried out this hoax, that she wrote the negative messages, she created Josh. What exactly was her role in this?
Well, certainly I've heard all those things, and she did not create the MySpace account. She did not instruct anybody to create the MySpace account. She never made any communications through the MySpace account.
What was her role then?
These teenage girls that, and I it's a little hard to explain without giving names, but I'm absolutely not going to give names of these teenage girls, and my client does not want me to do that, and that's been...
I'll do it for them. Sarah Drew and Ashley Grills.
Part of the problem is she doesn't want to put those names out in the public, and to have them have the same things happen to them that's been happening to her.
Was she in favor of this sting operation taking place?
She knew these girls were doing it, and she didn't stop it. She wished she did. If she could turn back the clock, that's the part that she would do differently.
Did she know at the time that Meghan Meyer was being treated for ADD and she had a history of bipolar condition?
She wasn't sure about... She knew the ADD. The other stuff, she wasn't sure. She thought maybe there was some condition that was, like, similar to that, but she didn't know.
Because that's the question people ask. If she had that information, how could she have let this go on?
Well, first of all, everything as far as Ms. Drew knew was that all the communication was nice and polite, and there was no harassing going on. In fact, it's undisputed that there were no negative, mean comments, no cyberbullying at all until the last 24 hours before Meghan took her own life.
And that's sad.
And that time, when those messages happened, Mrs. Drew was not in the residence. She did not know these things were happening. She didn't find out that these negative comments happened until after...
So you're willing to state unequivocally she had absolutely nothing to do with the negative...
Here comes another call.
Nasty comments that were posted online about Meghan Meyer.
Absolutely, 100%. There's no doubt.
When she found out about it?
She didn't find out about it until after Meghan had taken her own life.
To what extent has the harassment now been targeting the Drews?
Mrs. Drew has had to close her advertising business because people have been attacking her advertisers and they want nothing to do with it. They don't want the bad publicity. Her friends and neighbors are afraid to talk to her because they're afraid they're going to be attacked next. Her daughter has had to drop out of school because of the harassment, so she's not in school. They don't know what they're going to do as far as getting her into school. Right now they let her take classes. They do work outside of class, but that can't go on forever. Living in the neighborhoods it may be impossible in the future. I mean, she doesn't know how she's going to handle that. It's not... You know, people know it's not so easy just to move, and that's it's a very terrible
situation. It says Lori Drew is a psychopath.
Mr. Briscoe, thanks very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Domenico. Well, Waterford Crystal Drive is one of those quiet Midwest streets that seems to be the perfect place to live. But the suicide of teenage girl Meghan Myers and allegations that she had been tormented by a neighbor, Lori Drew, over the internet have people there up in arms. Neighbors now want the Drew family to move out of the area as soon as possible. Meghan's mom, Tina Meyer, was on the live desk recently and said that she feels no remorse for how neighbors are treating the Drews.
It is an adult who did this. And now the public is saying, we're not going to stand for this. So do I feel sorry for her? No. Do I want any harm coming to her children? Absolutely not.
All right, joining me now by phone is Christine Buckles.
I mean, of course she doesn't want any harm to come through her family. So of course she doesn't want any torture to come to... harm to come to the family. Tina is a smart lady.
And allegations that she had been tormented by a neighbor, Lori Drew, over the internet have people there up in arms. Neighbors now want the Drew family to move out of the area as soon as possible. Meghan's mom, Tina Meyer, was on the live desk recently and said that she feels no remorse for how neighbors are treating the Drews.
It is an adult who did this. And now the public is saying, we're not going to stand for this. So do I feel sorry for her? No. Do I want any harm coming to her children? Absolutely not.
All right, joining me now by phone is Christine Buckles, the next-door neighbor of Lori Drew and good friend of Tina's. Christine, thanks for being here. What are people in your community saying about the Drew family?
Well, everyone in our community wants them out. They feel that they do not belong in our community. After what they've done, we just want them gone.
Do you think that this is vigilante justice? Are you doing things to this family to coerce them or urge them to leave the neighborhood?
No. Actually, we just kind of ignore them. Since the stories broke, we have not seen much of them at all. which is actually very nice to us, but we just want them gone. We don't want to have to deal with them. We don't want to look at them every day.
Well, we've actually heard that there's more than just ignoring going on, and that there is actually sort of a nasty website that has been created targeting Lori Drew, the mother. Do you know anything about this?
I don't.
When you do see your neighbor, I mean, this is your neighbor after all, if you cross paths as you're going to the grocery store or as
you're... So it's probably 3 to 5 houses down from Megan, maybe?
They're going to school. What's that exchange like?
Because they were 4 houses down.
Lori Drew will not look at me. She will not look me in the face.
What about all the kids in the neighborhood? How are they treating the Drew children?
None of them, the Drew children really haven't been seen since the story broke either. So there's not been a whole lot of communication with the Drews and anyone since the story broke.
If you want them to leave the neighborhood and that's your ultimate goal, how will you begin exerting pressure for them to do that?
I don't believe we can. I think that's something that they have to feel that they need to leave. I mean, I don't think that as a neighbor there's any way I can force someone out of the neighborhood other than to voice my opinion, which is exactly what I'm doing. I have no qualms about saying that I know that I speak for several of the other residents in our neighborhood.
Oops. Spilled water everywhere on my shirt. I think I just choked over my own breath somehow.
Want them out.
I just started choking. It's possible to choke over your own breath. What's more, when you choke over food, it can also make you not able to breathe sometimes.
That's all we can do.
Right. All right, Christine Buckles, thank you so much for joining us with your candid opinion this morning. Let's see what today's A-list has to say about this. Angela McGlaurin is a Fox political analyst. Peter Johnson Jr. is a Fox News legal analyst. Lauren Lake is a criminal defense attorney. And today's Fox wildcard, Fox senior judicial analyst, Judge Andrew Napolitano. Thanks so much for being here, guys. I think that neighbors feel as though they need to take things into their own hands when they feel abandoned by the court system or by the criminal justice system. And this mother and this family is never going to be charged, even though this young girl is dead. Lauren, I want to go to you. You're a criminal defense attorney. How would you advise this family that has basically been turned into a pariah in this neighborhood? What should they do?
Move. Hello. You know, let's just get real here. This was a terrible, terrible occurrence, and this mother really, really misbehaved. Now, whether or not the courts decide to follow through or the criminal justice system decides to follow through, I would honestly advise them, you don't have to move, but why wouldn't you? Why wouldn't you want a fresh start? Why would you sit here in this home and remind this family constantly that their daughter is gone and there may be some small feeling that you may have something to do with it?
You know, there's a category of, and I agree entirely with Lauren, there's a category of behavior, reprehensible but not remediable. That is, it's so wrong, but there's nothing the courts can do about it.
And it's actually, why wouldn't they move? Because there are so many people over there who don't even like them.
And ostracizing people is a classic traditional way of community punishment when the behavior hasn't risen to the level of a crime.
Okay, so but let's say it ends up going a little bit a notch above ostracizing, Peter, and they end up doing things like leaving nasty notes, or they make prank calls, or this threatening website. Then does it rise to the level of anything criminal?
I mean, I can't believe this. This is a disturbing, dark, short story almost. Yeah, it can rise to the level of something criminal. And what I'm concerned about is, where are the local spiritual and political leaders bringing some sense of redemption or cohesion or clarity to this community? Should a tragedy beget another tragedy? Should another child die in that Drew household? Should this woman, who may have committed these acts that may have, according to some people, resulted in this child's suicide, should she be driven to suicide? Is that what we need?
And two wrongs don't make a right, never have and never will.
Is that what we want?
But forgiveness is hard, Angela.
Forgiveness is hard, and I think that a lot of people are grieving here and they're lashing out, but having a loved one...
I usually forgive people pretty easily because, you know, that's what God says to do, is to forgive.
that did commit suicide. I want to say this, we're playing the blame game here. And committing suicide is just not one act that will cause you to do that. And I think that the parents of the young lady should take the responsibility, because for someone to take their own life, they have to be really desperate. And this child could have been manic depressive.
Oh, there obviously
this child could
was
have
a
had
problem.
Certain issues.
There
but
obviously
I,
was a problem with
yeah,
the child. But
right.
Your next door neighbor, the mother,
but still,
cannot
Judge,
be allowed to get away with this.
But what are they going to charge,
I mean,
them with charge her with manslaughter?
No, no, no. I don't think she committed a crime. That's why I said reprehensible, but not criminal.
Right. And there's so much to should just here, move. Just move. Now, if not for her own sake or the sake of the
Could you guys stop talking over people? Just let some people talk.
The child that died.
Not trying to be rude. I just hope that they just...
For her own family's sake.
Okay, Alice, there's so much material here for...
An internet harassment case out of St. Charles County has been in the news lately. Good evening, everyone. I'm Jim Reed.
And I'm Lauren Whitney in for Angie. 13-year-old Megan Meyer killed herself last year after receiving online harassment by someone she thought was a teenage boy. That boy turned out to be a mother of one of the girl's friends.
Today, Megan Meyer's mother was in Mid-Missouri to talk about online harassment.
It's a new crime that lawmakers and law enforcement are scrambling to keep up with, and KOMU's Ashton Goodell shows us how Tina Meyer is battling cyber bullies.
Tina Meyer says she has a mission to educate people about the dangers of cyberspace.
An adult is not, you know, should not be allowed or able to hide behind a computer and harass a child.
Meyer says her daughter's webpage on MySpace.com allowed cyberbullies to take advantage of Megan. She says,
I got harassed in fifth grade. One kid called me gay in front of a playground lady, and she told him to not do it, and he said okay. But did he listen? No, he was an asshole back then. So one time he said, "Ew, get away, you're gay," and then he said, then one time he went, "Gay, gay, 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 gay." He kept on saying, "Gay, gay, 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 gay," with his eyes closed and shaking his head, or just calling me gay, 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 over and over again. And then the fifth grade teacher said, "That is harassment, and you will be suspended." That is actually harassment, calling someone gay. And he said, even though I hugged other guys, like hugging my friends, he said that's gay. If you hug a guy, that's not gay.
Online bullies are just as real and just as dangerous as school bullies.
They bullied about weight, bullied about, you know, just everything in general. I mean, everybody's been bullied, but Megan was certainly bullied about weight.
She met with Governor Blunt's Internet Harassment Task Force.
So was I.
Today to encourage
bullied about weight, called fat ass.
Them to reconsider current stalking and soliciting statutes to protect children from online harassment.
If it should happen again, be able to have laws in place that will keep families from having to go through what we went through.
The best way to avoid harassment or unwanted solicitation is by 1. Monitoring your children's website and online chats. 2. Use website filters.
Or block the people who are harassing you.
And 3. Talk to your children about internet safety. Ashton Goodell, KOMU News, Jefferson City.
The task force reviewed current statutes and compared internet laws from neighboring states. For more internet safety tips, you can go to our website at KOMU.com.
Charges may be brought against a mother involved in an internet hoax that may have led to a 13-year-old girl, Megan Meyer, committing suicide. The Missouri teen was found hanging in her closet in October of 2006 after she allegedly received cruel messages on MySpace from a boy named Josh. One message read, "The world would be better off without you."
All of a sudden, my heart just dropped, and I just had this god-awful feeling. And I took off running upstairs and opened a door, and I saw her hanging in a closet. And I just screamed.
Problem was, Josh wasn't real. The online profile was actually made up by a teenage employee of a woman living just doors down from Megan in suburban St. Louis. The neighbor apparently wanted to know what Megan thought about her own daughter. Missouri officials eventually decided not to press any charges because no laws...
That's kind of a lame statement. That is actually kind of a lame... Will you please excuse me? Sorry for the inconvenience one last time. To really hurry this video up.
The bird to apply in the case. The intention and the purpose of creating this and the purpose of the conversations that were going back and forth of trying to get this young girl to become her friend was so they could find out what Megan was saying about Mrs. Drew's daughter. But the Los Angeles Times reports federal prosecutors are considering bringing fraud charges against the woman.
This is part one. I have to finish this up now. So this is the end of this video, and I'll do part two later. Thank you all for watching. Stay tuned for the part two of this video. I'm 1 hour and 16 minutes in, and it's 1 hour and 45 minutes. So this is part one. Thank you for watching. Bye.